raise the world.
Bragg Stockton brings the Houston Cougars to Lubbock today with an exciting array of offensive talent. But after losing to Texas Tech yesterday, they'll need to sweep today to vie for a postseason berth. In Lubbock, Larry Hayes' Red Raiders form the top pitching corps in the Southwest Conference, the top defense in the league, and the second-ranked offense. Today, the Raiders and the Cougars head for a collision next on HSE College Baseball. Presents the best in Southwest Conference baseball as today the Houston Cougars battle the Texas Tech Red Raiders. This is the second game of a three-game series. Last night's first game went to Texas Tech 11-3 with Nye getting his fifth complete game, featuring nine strikeouts, leading the way for Tech in a game that featured a total of 20 hits. And a very pleasant good afternoon, everyone. Greg Lucas here along with Norm Miller. We talk about those 20 hits, Norm. We expect some hits because some of the best hitters in the Southwest Conference are on the field. In fact, three of the top five.
That's right. The Cougars bring in Buteau and Freeman, who both can hit the ball out of the ballpark and are good average hitters. On the other side, Tech has a well-rounded team of hitters, Brandon Welch leading them at 393.
You know, not only do they have a well-rounded team of hitters, this Tech team is well-rounded altogether. You can hit, you can pitch, you can play defense. That's what it takes.
Well, that's what it takes to win ball games. They're way up in the stats in hitting, in pitching, and defense, and that's why they're having a great year.
Now, as you can see, second, first, and first, they are, in fact, the first-place team in the Southwest Conference going into play today. They're going to take on a Houston team, which maybe didn't show as well last night, but overall has a good record, though they are under 500 in league play. And one of the reasons they've been good for the balance of the year is the great play of Shane Buteau. Talk about well-rounded. How can you be more well-rounded than he?
Well, he's way up in statistics and hitting. He's leading the league in home runs. He's got RBIs. He's got stolen bases of 23. And here's an unusual stat. He's also got saves.
Yeah, he's got five saves coming out of the bullpen. Now, the pitching matchup could say that all that hitting is going to be negated because Matt Beach is going for Houston, and he's going against Jason Whittle for Texas Tech.
Right, right. Well, Matt Beach, a good left-handed pitcher, good fastball, curveball, and what's helped him this year is control. He's got to get his off-speed pitches over to be effective. And the one other thing he brings in today, a perfect game thrown back in February.
Whittle, of course, a strong pitcher as well. You stay with us. We'll have the first pitch and all the action from a breezy Dan Law Field after we take this time out. The Southwest Conference Game of the Week is brought to you by Southwest Airlines, the official carrier of the Southwest Conference.
It's time for friends to fly free on Southwest Airlines.
Wake up and smell the coffee.
And people are friendlier than ever. Just make reservations at least a day in advance and buy your round-trip ticket at Southwest's regular low unrestricted fare, and a friend flies with you, free, anywhere we fly.
Yo! Dad, what do you think?
Friends fly free on Southwest Airlines. It's just plain smart.
Yo, check it out. Here's what I gotta know.
Did you guys come out to play or what?
Oh, showtime.
Come out to play.
Yo, any Gatorade in the house, y'all?
This thirst is getting deeper.
Gatorade, can you quench my thirst all the way to the soles of my size 13s?
So if you come out to play without your Gatorade, you better
call your mother to pick you up.
Gatorade thirst, when it jumps for that deep down body thirst.
When you need an auto part, you don't need to search high and low.
I'd never been to an auto parts store before.
A friend said she'd save money doing it herself.
I never would have thought I'd change a headlight.
I told her it was a lot easier than it looked.
The Hilo guy told me how, step by step.
Knew she could do it.
Knew I could do it.
She could get a headlight anywhere. What she needed was Hilo.
Jeff Bagwell, two-time Astros MVP. Craig Biggio, two-time All-Star. Luis Gonzalez hit 300 last season. Ken Caminiti,
the gun.
Steve Finley led National League in triples. We're ready to take another run at the pennant. This is the year. Astros Baseball. Call 799-9567 to order season tickets.
Welcome back to Dan Law Field, everyone. Greg Lucas along with Norm Miller as we're going to have Southwest Conference baseball for you. The second game of this three-game series between Texas and the University of Houston, Texas Tech and University of Houston. Here's the UH lineup. Leading off at shortstop is Ryan Elizondo, then Carlos Perez in left field. Ricky Freeman is the first baseman. Shane Buteau is in right field. Tom Molesky, the designated hitter. J.J. Matzke is at third base. Dustin Carr in center field. Mike Hatch, the catcher. And Todd Whitting is the second baseman. Defensively for Texas Tech, the outfield will have Bennett, Homestead, and Gregg, with Bryant, Bustos, and Totman around the infield. Duras at first base, of course. Lindstrom is catching, and the pitcher is Jason Whittle.
Well, Greg, Jason Whittle is a big right-hander. He's 6'1", 231 pounds. He's having a good year. He's 7-3, 2.81 earned run average, 76 strikeouts in 64 innings, third in the Southwest Conference.
Of course, the coach of Texas Tech is Larry Hayes. He's had great success here, first at Lubbock Christian, then here at Texas Tech. He has quite a lineup that he will be sending out. We'll take a look at that a little bit later on as we're just about set to get this underway. But one of the real surprises of Larry Hayes' team this year has been the play of first baseman Randy Duras. Duras had not been a power hitter until this year, but all of a sudden he's been hitting the ball out of the park. And the coach, some thoughts on that.
Well, you know, everyone's saying we've hit a lot more home runs here than we have the last couple of years, but we're still not a home run hitting club. And Randy is an execution type player. He's a great bunter, a good hit and run player. And this year he's in those situations where, you know, where he's trying to drive in runs. He's been getting the pitches, and, you know, he's done a good job. And in high school he was a home run hitter, hit a lot of home runs, and we're glad to see him getting that stroke back. But we don't want him to forget what has made him a great player here at Tech.
Hitting the bottom of the inning. Meanwhile, Ryan Elizondo leads things off. Elizondo, the shortstop, 206, no homers, three RBIs. And the count quickly goes no balls and two strikes. Elizondo, a junior college transfer from Corpus Christi. He went to San Jacinto Junior College after Moody High School and originally was signed by Texas Tech. Mac, last night, the bench, not the bench jockeys, but the folks in the stands were giving it to him, having left the location, and he is quickly out on a called third strike. Let me quickly point out, too, you'll see some shakiness of the picture. Very simple reason. It's hard to hold steady when the wind is whipping out of the right field to left field side. It has really picked up, Norm.
Well, I'm a little concerned with the guy above us. We're inside here, and we're safe for now, but we got a camera on the roof here that I'm a little concerned with.
It's that typical West Texas wind that has kicked up. Carlos Perez takes the first pitch outside for a ball. Carlos, 357, a homer, and 13 runs batted in. This Houston team has a 25-17 record, which is very good, but in conference play, they're 4-6, and as was indicated in the opening comments, they've got to win some games here in this series and the rest of the way to make the postseason tournament field. Perez retired on a fly to Gregg. They're two outs quickly.
Well, their big problem, Gregg, is, as Coach Stockton told us, and it's obvious by looking at stats, is pitching. And the real problem is their bullpen. He just doesn't have anybody that can keep him close at the end of the game. And he last night we saw him run one guy in after another. And if you don't have somebody that can close it down, it's hard to win a lot of ball games.
Well, Larry Hayes has a great pitching staff. Whittle just one of them with that 7-3 record, 2.81 earned run average. Now he's facing one of those top five hitters in the league, Ricky Freeman. Ricky, a veteran, 396, seven homers, and 34 runs batted in. Ricky last year hit in his college career, 338 average. Last year at 384, he's been one of the top hitters in the Southwest Conference the last three seasons. He was all Southwest Conference as a junior last year. The count even, now one ball and two strikes.
I was in the dugout before the game talking to Coach, and Freeman came up, and the first question was, are you going to let me play on TV today, Coach? Does that require an answer?
I was going to say, he's not going to be missing many games. 6'4", 210-pounder, senior from Houston, Bel Air High School. Whoops, and he gets plunked right between the shoulder blades, and that was a breaking ball that didn't do much except maybe try to break a shoulder blade. He's on first base.
Well, let's take a look at the replay. I don't know if it got him in the back of the head or the shoulders. Oh, that's a fastball that just got away right there on the shoulder.
And he's at first base. And I'm sure he wants to relive this moment again on Memorex.
Oh.
I don't know. Maybe that was the bottom of the batting helmet. But it might have glanced. In any event, he's on. And we'll take a look at Shane Buteau as soon as Ricky shakes the cobwebs out. Buteau has had an incredible season. 393, 10 home runs, 47 runs batted in. And this is a guy that last year hit 325. Good, right? But where's the power come from? Just like Randy Duras, all of a sudden this year the power. Now, Shane is big enough for it, 6'4", 195 pounds. But last year he had just one home run.
Well, I think a lot of it comes from confidence. You know, in talking to Duras and in talking to Buteau, they're both a little more patient at the plate. And they're trying to hit some balls out of the ballpark, but they're trying to hit them on the pitches they should be when they get ahead in the count, 2-0, 3-1.
Well, he showed, I think, last night why he has such a good average. No balls in a strike. He's facing Nye, who's an outstanding pitcher, who handled him earlier easily. But then when Nye made a mistake, a triple. And then he makes another mistake, another base hit. That's what good hitters do.
Absolutely.
No balls in a strike. Runner at first goes. Pitches away. The throw through is not in time. A stolen base for Ricky Freeman. That's his 11th of the year. He's only been caught once. Houston will have to be a little more aggressive, I think. One thing that took them out last night, 5 runs in the first 2 innings, and they were really never in it after that.
Yeah, they never got off to a good start last night. Of course, that's what Coach Stockton said to us, that, you know, they felt like they were in the hole and playing catch-up. And playing catch-up in this ballpark against a Tech team that can hit the way they do is pretty tough.
Lindstrom making a nice stop there just to keep that one from getting back to the screen. Meanwhile, the ball fouled away. Count is 1 ball and 2 strikes. It's 82 degrees at game time, sunny and very windy.
Very windy.
Yes, and it really picked up. He probably noticed it while we were doing our open down on the field. It just about started then. And he went after a bad one, and that retires the side. So Buteau strikes out. One runner left on base. Bottom of the first coming. We'll check the Tech lineup when we return.
Frontier now has the absolute biggest and best selection of family vehicles ever. Just take a look at this 1985 Ford LTD automatic. 6-cylinder with air and more for only $49.88. It's your choice. This 1990 Mitsubishi Galant LS, automatic, 4-cylinder with air, AM/FM cassette and more. Or this 1990 Chevrolet Corsica, automatic, 4-cylinder with air, AM/FM and more for only $69.88. Or this 1990 Honda Accord EX, automatic with air, AM/FM cassette and more for only $99.95. What values? And remember, used cars come with a warranty at Frontier.
Seen the courage of heavyweight champion Evander Holyfield.
Holyfield's gunning for a summit here.
Now meet his next challenger, Michael Moore.
They say I'm wild.
And Moore scores twice with the uppercut and Stewart is down again.
They say I'm mean and arrogant.
Oh, but down it goes.
I say they're right. Boxing's a tough business.
Pay-per-view is your ringside seat for all the live action.
Greg Lucas back along with Norm Miller. We're going to the bottom of the first. College baseball and HSC. Texas Tech coming up. Let's take a look at the Texas Tech batting order. Leading off in right field will be Brody Gregg. And that's a real platoon situation. We'll explain why we say that in a moment. Randy Duras at first base. Jason Totman at second base. David Lindstrom, the catcher. Saul Bustos, as they pronounce it here, at shortstop. Clint Bryant at third base. Marshall Bennett in left field. Luke Potter, the designated hitter. And Dax Homestead in center field. Defensively for Houston, around the outfield, they will have Perez, Carr, and Buteau with Matzke, Elizondo, Whitting, and Freeman on the infield. Hatch catching Matt Beach, the lefty.
Well, he's 6'2", 109 senior, and he comes in this game at 4-2 with a 3.22 ERA, 51 strikeouts, and 58 innings. And as I said earlier, a perfect game. Back in February 19th against Louisiana Tech, I believe.
Yes, he did. He was, and I think it's interesting. It was explained why he's pitching the seven-inning game, because people would wonder, he's the ace of the staff. Why don't he pitch the nine-inning game? Well, Brad gave you an answer to that.
Yeah, he said he basically, after seven innings, gets tired and loses it, so he felt he'd rather see him in there where he can go strong all 7 innings than bring in somebody from the bullpen if he has to.
And then kind of scramble in game two if you have to, I guess, too. Brody Gregg is leading off. Now, the reason I said this is a true platoon situation, Brody's a right-handed batter. And who is he playing in place of? Well, only one of those top five hitters in the South, five hitters in the Southwest Conference, Brandon Welch, a lefty at 393 with 8 homers. He'll sit this first game out, at least the start of it. Greg, 276 with a homer, 7 runs batted in. Of course, he also adds a lot of speed. He is really the best base stealer, so they give up some hitting, but they get their base stealer in there. Greg has stolen 13 times. One ball and a strike. Brody's a veteran. Last year hit 300 with 2 homers and 17 stolen bases. And he's ahead on the count. 2 balls and a strike. The home plate umpire is Wade Ford.
Well, the big difference in Beach this year is his control. Last year he had a lot of walks. He still has a lot of walks, but he's cut him way down, and he's getting his off-speed pitches over, and that makes a big difference for a pitcher like him who's not overpowering.
There's a good example right there. It's 2 balls and 2 strikes. He took a little off, got it over, and the count's even. Brody Gregg will be facing Beach, who has, you know, had such a good season for this Houston team, which is low in pitching. Team earned run average in Houston is, what, 5.33, and his is in the low threes, so that shows you how much of a factor he's been. That ball slapped right side, dropping, but the first baseman thinks he's got it gauged, and Freeman does, one out.
Let's take a look at Matt Beach on the mound here and see how kind of delivery he's got. What I like so far, what I see, he's got his eyes focused right on that target. Nice, simple delivery, good balance. He picks up the target, throws a little bit across his body, just a little bit. A nice, easy motion, good release point right out in front.
He would appear also, from what we heard on the sidelines, to be one of those, I won't say typical baseball players, but one of the many baseball players that's somewhat superstitious with his ritual. I heard him decide to find out what time the game was going to start, and he told his bull, the guy's going to catch him warming up, we'll start at 11:48.
Well, first of all, he's left-handed. Now, that's the first clue, isn't it?
We won't start at about 11:50 or, no, 11:48. He had it. 2 balls and no strikes.
Well, when you pitch a perfect game, you get a little strange after that.
He also wants to get cued in if we happen to have a long break. He wants the sideline red cap to let him know how much time is left so that he can gauge his warm-up pitches. He doesn't want to stand around a long time after his last warm-up pitch. I mean, he's leaving no stones unturned. 2 balls and a strike.
God, I hope he slept last night after sitting up thinking about all this stuff for us.
Randy Duras, 10 home runs, even though he has used a lot the sacrifice bunt. We saw him do that in the first inning last night, and then later in the game he had a home run.
Well, it's an interesting. He leads the team in walks, on sacrifice flies, sacrifice bunts, home runs, and he says he's not a home run hitter. He blames it all on the wind.
Well, I'll tell you, he hit one again last night, and he's up to 10. Puts him among the leaders in the league. Chops it to the third baseman on a high hop. Matzke, 2 down.
I think the big difference in why he's hitting some home runs, he hit them in high school. He got in college and he became a little bit of a role player, and hitting second, getting runners over, kind of slapped at the ball. But now he's taking more of a swing, especially when it's 2-0, 3-1, when there's men in scoring position. And he's getting the ball out of the ballpark. But watch him when he gets men on base. He'll start to sacrifice or do whatever it takes to win a ball game.
Jason Totman, 417 with 3 homers and 24 runs batted in. That one's a ball. 1 ball and no strikes. Jason, an infielder, playing second base out of McPherson, Kansas, and a transfer from Butler County Community College. A minor irony here. His average of 417 is exactly what it was last year in junior college, when the year was all over.
Another thing we have to watch for from Beach, you've got a windy day blowing out. Will he change his style of pitching? I hope not. You got to go with what you're used to and what your power is. And with him, that's keeping the ball down, changing speeds, and throwing strikes.
He wasn't happy after the release of that pitch as he kind of gingerly walked back to the pitcher's mound. 2 balls and a strike.
Well, he tried to overthrow a breaking ball, and he knows better. But like I said, with this win, you try and do some things you're not capable of doing, and you get hurt more by trying to do that.
That ball's fouled back to the screen. 2 balls, 2 strikes, 2 outs. We're in the bottom of the first. Again, a Southwest Conference scheduled doubleheader, which means the first game is slated for 7 innings, and the second game scheduled for 9. There'll be about a 30-minute break between them. We'll have both games for you. 2-2. Another slow breaking ball missing outside, and it's full.
You know, one thing that's interesting, we're talking about the win here in the first inning. I think the center fielder and right fielder are playing really too shallow. You know, it's much easier to come in off a ball than it is to go back. And last night, they had some problems.
So far, the pitching has been so dominant, though, it's not been a problem. Each pitcher having little problem through one. We'll go to the second with no score.
SEC Baseball for plenty of RBIs, ERAs, SPs, Ks, and HRs. So watch ASAP, okay? Vanderbilt in Auburn, Saturday night at 9 on HSE. Racing, it's a real drag. The nation's meanest machines go head-to-head to see who is the real deal on wheels. The 25th Annual Cater Nationals, Sunday on HSE.
We're back here getting set for the second inning. It'll be Molesky, Matzke, and Carr. There you see last night's winner, Ryan Nye. He has had an outstanding season. And last night, he, you know, with a couple pitches back, he would have had a shutout. He was that dominant.
Well, there were a lot of scouts here last night. I say a lot, five or six. And they were all here for one reason, and that was to watch him pitch. And he showed them enough. There was he threw some good fastballs up in the 90, 91 range. They could teach him that breaking ball.
Yeah, he's mostly a fastball pitcher. He got in a little trouble with the breaking ball. Here's Molesky now. And an excuse me slap back to the screen. Tom hitting 360 with three homers and 21 runs batted in. Molesky is from Richardson, Texas, near Dallas. Went to Berkner High School. And a transfer from Navarro Junior College. And quickly, it's no balls and two strikes. Well, these pitchers, at least through one inning plus, have... learned the lesson of how to pitch. Throw that ball over the plate, challenge the hitters, make them hit your stuff. Now, that was an interesting pitch there. That looked like it was exactly where he wanted to throw it, even though it was not over the strike zone. It was right where the catcher was.
Well, maybe they're trying to see early how far they can push these umpires.
Well, that was one ball, two strikes, so that's kind of your waste pitch. Let's try to get it out here and see if the hitter goes for it. Foul tipped, but the throw to first base, not foul tipped, just dropped, and the throw to first base retires Molesky. So we'll take a look at Matzke here in a moment.
Take a look here. After the catcher has trouble with the ball, one thing, he got real lucky on this. If we can get him back in the screen. What he's supposed to do is take his time and get out in front of the plate. But he didn't. And consequently, was throwing almost right into the back of the runner.
Yeah, because he had plenty of time. That's fastball strike to J.J. Matzke, 279 with four homers. And... 27 runs batted in. Last year, J.J., big hitter, 397. And this ball is driven to center field, a deep. Back for it is Helmstead, and he gets to it before he runs into the wall. Helmstead, at least it's his home field. He knows what that wind can do, and it did carry that ball, two outs.
Well, we saw last night, the Tech outfielders played everything real well, real comfortable. And the Cougars were having some trouble. But that's why I say in a win like this, why not play back a few extra steps and make the ball stay in front of you?
Well, you see, that's pretty much how Tech plays.
I know if I was Coach Stockton, I'd be telling my outfielders right now, you see that? That ball wasn't hit that hard. Look where it was caught at, 405 feet. Mm-hmm.
Dustin Carr, the hitter now. Dustin has not hit one this year. He's hitting 250 with no homers and five runs batted in. Carr is from Mount Vernon, Texas. A sophomore, redshirted during his regular freshman season, but had a strong fall in 93, got a chance.
Boy, Whittle looks like a linebacker out there, doesn't he? Boy, he's a big boy.
He looks like a linebacker, and Carr, in fact, is a football player for Houston, a walk-on, who also plays football. And the count is now one ball and two strikes.
Whittle comes from one of those great hometowns, Rancho Cucamonga, out in California.
You're Californian. What is that, Southern California?
It's Southern somewhere.
That's a fastball wide. It's two balls and two strikes. Houston and Texas Tech, no score in the second. Breaking ball on the ground. And through the shortstop, and Bustos does something that the Tech doesn't do a lot, make errors. But he did there, and that's the second base runner now for Houston. Let's see, Bustos, the shortstop, now has 12 errors for the year.
Well, he just didn't get down. He got a little lazy on that ball. Never quite got that glove down, and ball took a little hop down at the end. He stabbed at it. He sits.
In the background, you can hear some of the hecklers there in full swing. Here is Mike Hatch, the catcher. Took him a while to warm up, I think. Shouldn't have. It's warming up already.
I don't know. Last night, they started right in that first inning. In fact, they started before the first inning.
Mike Hatch, a catcher, 5'7", 185-pounder, 225 average. They do all they can to help the Houston players. Hatch, 225, two homers, 16 runs batted in from Springdale, Arkansas. Trying to keep the runner close, and you wonder why. Well, Carr has some speed, hasn't run a lot. He's 3 out of 3. But he can get down there. In fact, he is a great base stealer. In high school, he had 25 stolen bases as a senior. And, of course, those high school seasons are sometimes not that long. One ball.
Well, I think we're going to see some running today with this win, as many runs it might take to win a ball game. And plus, Coach Stockton's got to come out aggressive. Last night, they were flat. He's going to try and make something happen early.
Pitch just misses outside. Two balls and no strikes. And, of course, Tech, a team that has not run a lot this year, ran wild last night, and I would think they would continue. It's the same catcher, and he was having some trouble with his throws. There's a strike. Two balls and a strike. Elsewhere in the Southwest Conference, Rice and TCU were winners yesterday. TCU winning the first game of the series with Texas. And Rice has the most victories in the Southwest Conference, but in the loss column, this team here, along with TCU, both are on top with only two losses. Texas Tech, bouncing ball to short. Bustos fires it across, and that takes care of things. We have finished 1.5. There's no score.
Because most of our flights are short, this is what our meals look like on Southwest Airlines. It's also what our fares look like. Southwest Airlines. It's just plain smart. Southwest Airlines has one of the best on-time records in the country.
Mr. Smith, you're early.
Just something to remember. Southwest Airlines. It's just plain smart.
Attention college baseball fans. Now's your chance to pick the college player of the year and national all-star team. Plus, win a trip for two to the finals in Omaha. The Smith Series giveaway. To make your picks and enter the giveaway, call 1-900-976-VOTE or mail your info to this address. Remember, a portion of the proceeds go to help the kids at Texas Children's Hospital. Don't forget to catch the winners on the Smith Awards Banquet, June 23rd on your Prime affiliate. Call 1-900-976-VOTE and help us go to bat for kids.
No score here as we go to the bottom of the second. This is a big day for college baseball. College baseball's fiercest rivalries, A&M and Texas, Mississippi State, LSU, and Miami and Florida State University. Well, the Hurricanes and the Seminoles battle for bragging rights in Florida immediately following our doubleheader today. Then again tomorrow at noon right here on HSE, Miami and Florida State. Boy, that's a big one. As HSE and all members of the Prime family are your leaders for college baseball. Coming up in the second for Tech, it will be Lindstrom, Bustos, and Bryant. No score. This is Matt Beach. Looks like he's got some kind of a support underneath his right ankle, because that's his push-off ankle. Yeah, the right side, which is his left, but it's the ankle, the leg, which is on the rubber. And it looks like he's got some kind of a support underneath the sock. Well, that's Matt Beach. He didn't have any problems with anything in the first inning. He retired all three he faced. Now he'll face Lindstrom, Bustos, and Bryant. Lindstrom catching in this game and going into the cleanup spot. 329, three homers, 20 runs batted in. Lindstrom has come to the Southland from Minnesota, where he grew up, went to high school, transfer from Iowa Western after that. One ball and no strikes. David is 5'10", 185 pounds, a sophomore. Two balls, no strikes.
Those outfielders are still shallow.
Yep. Well, I guess they're going to have to be beaten a couple times. Well, on balls that maybe could have been caught, that's going to be the key. Balls over the wall, I guess it ain't going to make any difference. That's a strike. Two balls and a strike.
When it blew like this candlestick, I used to just lean against the fence and let it come to me. Play a zone.
This kind of reminds you of that, too. This is the way this wind is whipping around. The only difference is it doesn't have as many places to get caught and swirl. It's pretty much a straight wind. Three balls and a strike.
Well, the first inning, Beach was 17 pitches, 9 strikes, 8 balls.
17 pitches, nice and productive, although here he is off to the wrong foot as he walks Lindstrom leading off. Beach, as far as walks and strikeouts are concerned, 51 strikeouts and 32 walks. Not a great, what you'd call a great ratio. That's not quite as good a strikeout-to-walk ratio as you'd like. But his hits to innings pitched is good, 45 to 58 and two-thirds. Lindstrom at first has not attempted a steal. Saul Bustos, now playing shortstop this year, 315 average with two homers and six homers and 31 runs batted. And got off to a slow start this year, but he is bringing it back to where he was last year when he hit 348. Played on that one, and it's no balls and a strike. Matt Beach with that perfect game. In fact, he was a player of the week back early on before conference play against Louisiana Tech. Bustos, the hitter, is a senior, lettered last year, transfer from Odessa College. No balls and a strike, no score, bottom of the first, one runner on, nobody out. Slow breaking ball high as Bustos turned around as if to maybe lay it down. It's one ball and a strike. Well, Bustos, who handles the bat well, would be a prime candidate here for, if not a bunt, a hit and run, even though runner at first has not really demonstrated a whole lot of speediness this year.
Well, Coach Hayes says that's what they have to do to win. They've had a kind of an up and down offensive year. They've had some big games and they haven't played well offensively, so he's got to make some things happen. This is a good pitch. 2-0 right here is a good pitch to hit and run. The pitcher's got to come in. He doesn't want to fall behind. The hitter knows that. He can be focusing on one thing, and that's hitting that good pitch the opposite way.
I would think another thing would make Beach someone to hit and run on is especially the right-hand hitters. He's been throwing a lot of balls away. Well, that's the one you're going to hit to the right side without a whole lot of trouble. There's another one. He missed it badly. It's three balls and a strike. He's having a lot of trouble now. Everything is staying up and away. There's Larry Hayes.
Well, which one of those means hit and run or steal? I think he's going. I think we're going to have some movement right now.
Well, the pitcher's been a little wild. There's less of a gamble. It's ball four. You're there anyway. Doesn't go, though.
Doesn't go.
It would have been no problem because he would have been down there and two walks in a row. And he is basically leaving everything in the same spot, up and away, whether it's a fastball or a curveball. The hitter is going to be Clint Bryant. Bragg Stockton. Now those signals are for either defensive alignments as to who's going to cover second, whether they're going to run a pickoff play, or in some cases actual calls for the pitcher.
There's no telling with Bragg. He's got a lot of scientific thoughts behind this, doesn't he?
He's
scientist in there.
Well, he is, after all, has a doctorate. He's Dr. Bragg, if he lives up to it. Bryant, 275 with two homers and 24 runs batted in. Clint is a local player from Lubbock, Monterey.
As we said in the opening, his control can make or break him. And the first two hitters here walking puts him right in the hole.
And they bunt to move him around with a... Did he get the tag? I guess he did. Or did he not? Safe. Freeman thought he tagged him. The home plate umpire, Wade Ford, did not see it. And so right now, we got the bases loaded. Unless another umpire is asked and overrules.
Here it is on the replay. Oh, he missed it.
Looked like he missed it on that shot.
No, he missed it.
No.
And the runner stayed. He's got that three. He can stay in the baseline, move out within 3 feet, I believe it is. What Freeman should have done there possibly is let that ball roll because it was rolling foul.
Yeah, make the guy do it again. But
make him do it
now
again.
The bases are loaded on a play that was not executed. There's a fly ball shallow. The wind cuts it down in right field, caught by Buteau, and the throw will come in way offline, but you can't chance it on that with nobody out. There's one out now. So Marshall Bennett was up for one pitch, and he flies to right. I think you saw there, though, why they play the right fielder shallow. Any ball out there just gets chopped.
That ball drops straight down.
Yeah.
But I still say center and left need to be back.
Now we'll take a look at Luke Potter, the designated hitter in this game. Luke hitting 294 with no homers and 10 runs batted in. Potter's from Boulder, Colorado, a transfer from Trinidad County Community College. I like his name. His full name is Lucas Jones Potter.
Well, let's see if he's a little more patient. You know, here's an inning where your pitcher, Beach, is struggling. You got him in a hole. No outs, bases loaded, and Ben walk up and just swings at the first pitch. Sometimes that's not a good idea, to be too aggressive. Make the guy work a little bit.
Well, now he's got a great spot to make him work. It's two balls and no strikes. The Cougar infield, of course, playing on turf. If a ball is hit like a shot right at one of the second baseman or shortstop, they still could elect to come to the plate for force, but they're played back for a double play. And again, having trouble with that outside corner, it's now three balls and no strikes. No score, but a big threat here for Tech here in the second.
Well, I'll tell you what, this is... For a hitter, this is what you want. Bases loaded and 3-0 or 3-1.
That's 3-1. We'll see what Larry Hayes does. Looks like his hitter's got the green light. Didn't see a signal, and it's three balls and a strike. So Potter has a shot at just getting a good pitch if he doesn't get over anxious. Didn't have to worry about it. A run scores as Potter walks with the bases loaded.
That's a good piece of hitting. Some guys don't like to hit 3-0. You know, they tend to overswing. So he was probably taking 3-0. Then on 3-1, you have a tendency to really jack up. And here he waits and waits, and Beach is trying to keep everything away. Good piece of hitting by Potter.
So the bases remain loaded, and the number 9 man of the order, center fielder Dax Homestead, is up. Dax, a 333 hitter with a homer, 24 runs batted in. 1-0 Tech. Fastball high, just cannot get the zone. Trying to paint that outside corner. Ironically, in the first inning, Beach was getting it right there.
Well, Hatch, the catcher, might have to just move over and set up inside and force him to throw the ball in.
There. That's where he was throwing it in the first inning. He was getting that outside corner and hitting the target. It's now one ball and a strike. Homestead is another player from Colorado, Boulder, transfer from the University of Wyoming. One ball and a strike. Slow breaking ball popped up on the infield. And the shortstop makes it on the infield fly. He wouldn't have had to, but he does. That's the second out.
You know, when a pitcher's struggling, you can't go too far with him. You've got to change his momentum up a little bit. Hatch is a short guy, and he sits up real low. And he keeps sitting up on that outside part of the plate, it looks like. If he's missing, either change the pitches, make him throw a breaking ball low, or set up inside, force him to change up a little bit.
Well, he did on that last pitch. He literally forced him to change up. He threw one, an off-speed pitch, and Homestead kind of jumped out of his shoes. They're two outs now. Base is still loaded. Here's Brody Gregg. He popped up the first time up. No balls and a strike on a swing.
If Beach can get out of this giving up one run, he's done a heck of a job.
Sure has. He'll still kick himself because the one run would have been walked in, and that's about the last thing you want to see done. Three walks in the inning. There, that slow breaking ball didn't bite, and it's 1-1. One ball and a strike. Slammed back to the screen as he picked up a little steam on it. 1-2. You know, Beach, the pitcher, is from San Antonio, went to Clark High School there after, and then Navarro Junior College. He came to the University of Houston because of Bragg Stockton's reputation at improving pitchers. Well, he's had a few. Woody Williams, who last year spent a lot of time with the Toronto Blue Jays. When he played at Houston just a few years ago, he was a pitcher and a shortstop.
Well, he said in the opening, he's got to get his off-speed pitches over to be effective, and he's not doing it.
2-2, 3-2. Runners are on their horses, and of course, with two outs, a double scores three. Three-two pitch to Brody Gregg. Foul back, try it again. Dan Lawfield is scheduled to be the host for next year's Southwest Conference postseason tournament. They're going to add a couple thousand seats to get it up to 5,000. It's a nice facility. It's open aluminum seats. In fact, there had been some talk about bringing the tournament here if Tech didn't qualify, but apparently it's going to Texas. 7-3 ball counts and 5-3-2s. That's adds up to a lot of pitches for Beach early. And he walks in his second run.
I think somebody ought to go out and talk to him and settle down a little bit. First of all, he's opening up when he's throwing. That's usually trying to overthrow. That shoulder flies open, your arm drags through, and everything is outside. Everything is staying outside.
Well, Mr. Stockton no doubt is thinking about it. Claps the hands hard as he's got to face Randy Duros, the man we were talking about earlier with 10 home runs, 33 runs batted in. He grounded out the first time. High pop foul back either into or over the stands. That's in the stands. You can hear it. Randy Duros from Laverne, California. Damien High School there was the 1992 Southwest Conference Freshman of the Year. Slow breaking ball that cuts the plate. It's one ball and two strikes.
Now here's a situation where Duros puts on that home run thinking, or that power thinking. He's not going to sacrifice here with two outs, and a sacrifice fly ball doesn't do any good, so let's see if he takes a big swing.
Fouls it in the stands, right side. The count still holds.
He didn't get cheated.
Nope. One ball and two strikes. There you see the dugout area and the look at Randy Duros. One ball, two strikes. Elizondo does not make the play in time, and a run scores. Elizondo and Whitting didn't get together in time, and hustling down from first base, Brody Gregg, remember, he's got great speed, and he was hustling all the way.
Well, that'll drive you nuts. You got to know who's on the bases. That ball wasn't hit that hard. He just kind of took his time and flipped it over there. Second baseman was late in getting over also, and Gregg does have good speed.
So that'll be a fielder's choice, bad choice. And Jason Totman, the number nine man to hit in the inning.
Second baseman, number six, Jason Totman.
Totman struck out the first time, and now he's down on the count, no balls and two strikes. Three runs in, two of them walked in, and one of them, in fact, two of what I like to call plums, those are called plays unmade, have hurt the Cougars here. The tag, the miss on the tag on the bunt in that one. That's a play unmade. It's not an error, but it's not made. It was a play that should have been.
And you know, that's got to drive the coach crazy, because here's a guy who has videos, he teaches fundamentals, drills and skills all over Texas, and to sit and watch his teams make fundamental, you know, bad plays.
That was a bad play. And I think probably you're right. I think looking at that replay, you've got to kind of blame the second baseman more than the shortstop, because if he's there, they make the play. But Whitting didn't get there in time. Of course, hustling, running of Greg had a lot to do with that. One ball and two strikes.
Beach is really struggling with his curveball. You know, he keeps going to his mouth, and I haven't seen him do that. Maybe the wind is like cold weather, dries out your hand, you don't get that good grip.
Two balls, two strikes after 0-2.
You watch his delivery. He's throwing fairly straight up and down, and he's really not bending over and getting rid of that ball out in front.
Well, he almost got out of it as Totman gave him a hand there with a slow breaking ball that was going to be wide, but he got a piece of it. 2-2.
Well, Totman doesn't strike out much. In 180 bats, he's only struck out three times, so you got to count on this guy making contact.
He does. Left center racing over for it is the center field. He can't get to it. One run will score. Here comes two runs. Here comes three runs, and it's a triple.
Well, I'm not one to say anything about I told you so,
but
however,
I told you so.
Why hinder yourself from play? Now, this ball's not hit that hard. And if you watch a center fielder, see how he breaks across, and next thing you know, he's going back? Doesn't have a chance. You got to go back to where you surround the ball. You got to circle the ball and always keep it in front of you.
A six-run inning for Tech against Bragg Stockton's ace.
Boy, walks, and what do you call him? Unplays, plays?
Plays unmade.
Plays unmade.
Plums. There's a fly ball, short left, coming in for Perez toward the foul line. Makes the catch, that retires the side, but the damage done. Six runs on only two hits. A three-run triple by Jason Totman, and after two, Texas Tech leads it 6-0.
It's the Battle of the Sunshine State. Hang on tight, because the power of the Canes collide with the muscles of the tomahawk chop. The Hurricanes take on the Seminoles. Game two, Saturday night at 6, live on HSE.
Don't miss the first YWCA Llano Estacado Native American Gathering, April 22nd through the 24th, at the Lovett Civic Center. This is a dynamic educational and cultural experience for the entire family. Join Native Americans from 9 states and 10 nations as they share their culture, history, dances, arts, crafts, jewelry, and food. For additional information, call the YWCA at 792-2723.
Seen the courage of heavyweight champion Evander Holyfield.
Holyfield gunning for a stoppage here.
Now meet his next challenger, Michael Moore.
They say I'm wild.
And Moore scored twice with the uppercut and Stewart is down again.
They say I'm mean and arrogant.
Oh, but down he goes.
I say they're right. Boxing's a tough business.
Pay-per-view is your ringside seat for all the live action.
The time is right to build a winner. Driven by power, speed, and pitching, the Astros and Rangers have created the blueprint for success. The Brewers take on the Rangers Wednesday night at 7:30, live on HSE.
Third inning about to start with Houston well behind, and the old migraine may be kicking in with Bragg after he saw an ugly second inning. Texas Tech only did two things. They hit a triple, which might have been caught if the defensive alignment had been a little bit deeper, and a bunt single, which was supposed to be a sacrifice and which was misplayed. That's all they did. They did nothing. The rest of them were walks. So all those six runs, I guess you know, Tech scored them, but you really give them to Houston.
Well, also the ground ball short. Fourth at second. The second baseman's late in getting over on a fast runner.
Here's Todd Whitting, the second baseman, 313 average with no homers and four runs batted in, and he was thinking of bunting for a hit, takes a strike instead.
And that's what you like to see. Whittle went out in the first pitch, fastball. He's got a six-run lead. Go after the hitters now. Make them hit the ball until you get in trouble.
Well, Nye last night said that, boy, once they got five runs the first two innings, he started to feel pretty good. He said he didn't feel all that good when the game started. That is a fair ball. not in time. So Whitting legs it out. And he is safe at first base. Last inning, Whittle threw, they're calling that an error on the third baseman, Bryant. He threw 15 pitches, 10 of them were strikes. That's last inning. So he has been coming right after the hitters.
Well, that's a coach's dream, isn't it? The old fundamentals. Mm-hmm. Get the ball over the plate, let your defense catch it, throw them out. Let's go have a pizza.
Here's Elizondo. Elizondo, first time up, was called out on strikes. Working from the stretch for the third time. There have been three base runners now. A couple of errors by Tech, which is unusual.
Well, here Whittle needs to go after the hitter. Just forget about the guy in first. Let your infielders take care of the double play. Six-run lead, and Bragg, you know, maybe in the first couple innings when it was nothing-nothing, he'll play a little aggressive. I'd be surprised now if he's going to start running into some traps.
Well, and even if he does, even if he steals second base, it's 6-0. You got your hitters here. Runner at first has only stolen once this year. Duras does not make the tag either. This is a bad day for first baseman trying to tag runners.
Well, that's a tough play. He's holding the runner on. It's a high chopper. Whittle didn't get off the mound exceptionally fast. Plus, you know, you're supposed to, as a pitcher, break towards the line and then run up the line. In that case, he couldn't because Duras is there. We might have had a collision, and you know who'd win that one. Whittle, 231 pounds.
That's a first hit for Houston. It is an infield hit, and Carlos Perez, who flied to right. Well, you know, one big blast here by one of these Houston sluggers coming up, and they're back in the game. There's nobody out. Fastball looked like it had pretty good steam on it.
Well, he's got a lot of strikeouts per innings. You know, he's up in the league leaders for strikeouts. And until I saw him, I thought he was a hard-throwing guy because you see 6'1", 231 pounds. But he gets a lot of guys out with that breaking ball.
Missing inside. It's 1-1. One ball and a strike. Southwest Conference Baseball from Texas Tech. 82-degree afternoon under mostly clear skies here. Bunt miss. Throw through to second. Getting back in time is Whitting. One ball and two strikes.
What do you mean by mostly clear?
Well, it doesn't look a little hazy to you, doesn't it? It almost looks like there's dust in the air.
You're kidding. In Lubbock? This is a clear day, isn't it?
Well, this would be called air pollution if you were in New York or something, but it's just dust. One ball and two strikes.
As you say that, it picks up a little more when you hear it outside. How's our guy doing up on the roof?
He's strapped in.
Is he tethered down?
Yeah, he's he's on automatic. And a big strikeout as Perez fans for the first out.
There's that breaking ball. Let's take a look at this pitch. He took a lot off this pitch, and Perez was way out in front of it. Big right hand, just a big old overhand curveball in a good location, down and in. Tough pitch to hit.
Hey, Ricky Freeman, and you see the end of the swing on the strikeout. Freeman was hit by a pitch right in the upper shoulder or lower batting helmet last time up. There he drives the ball in the air to left field. Wind won't be enough to give that one a ride. And that is out number two.
See, they're playing a little deeper. See how that outfielder, he just let the ball come to him. You know, when you teach kids how to catch fly balls, even young little leaguers, always try and tell them, keep the ball in front of you. It's much easier to come in than it is to go back like we saw in that last inning.
So Tech outfielders do play.
Well, they've got an advantage. They play here every day.
They do play deep. And, of course, for Freeman and Buteau, you do. But Buteau's struck out his first time up. That's how he started last night, slowly. There's a drive. Way back. It is over and out of here. Shane Buteau with his 11th home run, and it's a 6-3 ball game. The Cougars are back within range.
Well, the scouting report on Buteau is he's an off-speed hitter. You don't see many of those. He doesn't hit the fastball particularly well from the belt up. They've been able to throw the ball by him. That right there was an off-speed pitch. Last night, that's what he hit for two triples, was an off-speed pitch.
Well, you know, you're right about that. You don't see as many off-speed breaking ball hitters in college, but if you do, those are the ones who are going to hit well because a lot of these pitchers throw a lot of breaking balls because they don't have that great heat.
And it surprises me, last night, Nye was throwing the ball right by him. Mm-hmm. Then he gets late in the game, Buteau's up there, and it's no balls, two strikes. He just threw two fastballs right by him, belt high, and he throws an off-speed pitch for a triple. Right there. You know, if you're a pitcher, Whittle, you have to be watching the night before.
Well, Buteau now has a 16-game hitting streak and 11 home runs, 50 runs batted in, and I dare say he's very close to a 400 hitter. He came in at 393 and one for two.
He's having a heck of a year.
Ooh.
And we got a ball game again.
They do. Molesky the hitter. Molesky struck out the first time. One ball and no strikes. All three runs, that's right, all three runs unearned this inning because of that leadoff error, and the second out would have been the third out. There's a base hit. That is now three hits, two of them solid, and J.J. Matzke will be the batter. Well, again, with the wind blowing out, Matzke is capable of making it a one-run game.
Well, he's a big boy. You get up next to him around the cage, he's a, you know, he looks about 28 years old, too.
He's never been a big power hitter. He had two last year, and he has four this year, but super hitter. Last year, he led the Southwest Conference with a .378 batting average, and that's why this year he is in a big slump at .279. There's a shot to the shortstop, Bustos. And Saul gets it over to Totman. That retires the side. So in the third, however, both teams do some scoring back-to-back. Houston gets three, but Tech leads it 6-3.
It's tough being a fan when your team isn't the home team, especially when I try to find coverage of my favorite team in the local paper. I'm lucky if I can find last week's score. But if you're like me, you'll be happy to know there's one publication that'll make you feel right at home. The Sporting News. You'll love the Sporting News, no matter what team you love, even if it is the home team.
Call this number now and get four issues of the Sporting News free. You'll get opinions and analysis, team-by-team reports, and coverage of all the college conferences, plus baseball, basketball, and hockey all year long. Call now and you'll get four free issues of the Sporting News. If you like them, you'll get 24 more issues at this great TV price. If not, just mark the bill, cancel, and owe nothing. The four issues are yours to keep.
So call now for the Sporting News, the publication that treats every team like the home team.
Call now and you'll get four great issues of the Sporting News free. Call 1-800-592-1222.
Back at the home of the Red Raiders, Dan Lawfield in Lubbock, Greg Lucas along with Norm Miller. Don't forget next weekend. Now, before the season, you say, Rice, TCO, it's a nice little game, folks. Those are two of the top four teams of the Southwest Conference. The Rice Owls and the TCU Horned Frogs going at it next week from TCU live starting at noon. Be sure to be with us for all the action. You'll get to see Jose Cruz, Jr. You've heard a lot about him. You'll get to see him. You'll get to see those TCU Horned Frogs. In fact, a lot of ex-Major League sons in that game. You got Jose Cruz, Jr., Nolan Ryan's son, Tom Greaves' son, and that'll be a good one next week.
They can all play a little bit.
They
that
sure
Cruz
can.
Boy can play.
There is the wind, as you can see, whipping out, and you take a look at Mr. Buteau, who whipped one out of here in the last half inning. As Texas Tech comes up after sending 10 men to the plate against Beach in the second inning. What did he throw? 40 pitches.
He threw a game.
Woo. Well, let's see what he's got left. Bustos walked and scored in that second. 6-3, Tech.
Last year, 93, Beach in 75 innings had 67 walks. And he's cut it about that down to maybe four or five walks a game. But he's got to cut it even down more because he's not an overpowering pitcher.
Now, one ball and one strike. Thing is, even if you're not an overpowering pitcher, it is very hard for a hitter on any level, hitters, to string four or five hits in a row to get it if you're getting it over the plate. But if you throw a walk or two in there, it's not hard to get two hits out of five hitters or whatever it may be.
But as we talked yesterday coming to the ballpark, we're talking about Claude Osteen, the pitcher and coach for the Rangers. 20 years in the big leagues by throwing strikes. And there's a whole bunch of ball players like that. If you can throw strikes in any league, you can win.
Leadoff base hit by Bustos.
Well, you know, the hitters have got to go up there now thinking everything's away. He's pitching everything away. Oh, big leg kick.
Yeah.
Look, he just reaches out and slaps at the right field.
That's all it took.
I like that leg kick.
Saul trying to get that average back to where it was. Here's Clint Bryant, who singled and scored. His single was somewhat tainted. He was trying to sacrifice, and Freeman, the first baseman, missed the tag on him.
You know, obviously, we're probably beating this to the ground, but Beach knows the wind's blowing out to left, and it's in his mind, I'm not going to give up many home runs.
Well, that one's to right center field, and that's deep, and that's going to go all the way to the gap. Going into third base, coming around. Here's the relay from shortstop to the play. That's his tag! He made the play! Nice relay. Took a gamble there, sending Bustos all the way from first base on that. And the Cougars executed it well. Actually, the key, I think, there was that the ball did not get through all the way to the wall. Carr got to it and took it before it got that far and was able to make the relay play. And was this,
That's the relay coming in. And the important thing there is they hit the cutoff man. They hit the cutoff man. He turned and picked up his target. The catcher made a pretty good throw. And Hatch really made a good play at home. By one, keeping his eye on that ball. Two, getting in front of that plate. And immediately getting on that runner and keeping him off the plate.
That went from the center fielder to the shortstop to the catcher. Going into second base is Bryant. That's the fourth hit of the game for Tech. Two in a row here in this inning, but they have it out. Marshall Bennett flied to right field his first time.
Well, things are stirring up. A few people are starting to walk down into the bullpen down the Cougar side.
Well, as well they should, obviously, in this inning, Beach has not been...
It's Kevin Boyd starting to loosen up, right-hander.
That ball is hit high in the air to short center. The center fielder Carr comes in, and a two outs.
Job, DC.
Two down for Luke Potter. And the runner on base, that's Clint Bryant. He's two for two. There's the action way down in left field. Again, because of the wind, when we go on the long lens, camera moves just a little bit. It looks like a huge move. And there you see the action there. Luke Potter, runner at second base with two outs. It's a 6-3 Tech lead. And again, this is a seven-inning ball game. This is the first game of the doubleheader, so
middle relief takes
see,
on a new
Yeah, we say third, but it's the equivalent of the fifth in a nine-inning game.
I'll tell you, if that wind starts blowing that third base umpire, then we got to get nervous.
Tell you what, there's only one way it would be worse, and that was if it blew this direction and was blowing into this booth. At least we aren't feeling it. There's a pitch out.
Yeah, if he starts moving, we're in trouble.
Tom Jenkins, longtime umpire in the Southwest Conference. Yeah, he's anchored at third base. Two balls and no strikes. Took something off and got him for the swinging strike. Two and one. Beach trying to, I think, vary his rhythm a little bit here. Last year he was 4-5 with a 5.23 earned run average, and Norm pointed out his control problems. That's where his biggest improvement has come. There's a strike.
I'll tell you the big difference right now, the last two pitches. He's come over the top a little bit. What I mean by that, a little more overhand and gotten the pitch over the plate or on the inside part instead of trying to fling the ball and keeping it away.
Interesting point that Greg Stockman made when we were talking with him before the game about pitching. Here's the 2-2 first. This is a little bit up. Talking about how he likes his pitchers, assuming they can do it, to vary their, a lot of things, where they're coming from. And you know, as a hitter, you get into a point where one thing as a hitter you like to know where you're going to be able to pick up the ball as soon as you can. And his theory, obviously, is that if the pitcher varies where he's coming from, that makes it that much tougher on the hitter. Of course, it's tough for a lot of pitchers to do that because that's almost like carrying three or four different styles.
Well, that's absolutely right. Some guys you can go out and say, hey, you have three release points, and you can get them to think. Some guys, if you get them to think, they can't play. Bragg has been known to get a lot of people to think.
Three balls and two strikes.
I couldn't play for Bragg.
Well, I know our other compatriot, Jim Kern, would say, well, I never thought. So, three balls and two strikes. That pitch is up, and he loses him.
You know, I talked to him a little bit today about his hitting, coaching hitting. And, of course, he, you know, that's about 3 hours. And my theory has always been get a good pitch, swing hard in case you hit it. So you can see right there there's a philosophical difference at the beginning of that conversation.
Dax Homestead popped up to the shortstop in that second inning. He is up now with two outs, two on. Number nine man in the batting order. And there's one ball.
Well, we said at the beginning, Beach is a seven-inning pitcher.
He's probably almost thrown his seven-inning worth of pitches.
Coach Stockton's on his way out there right now. I don't think Boyd's ready in the bullpen yet, but I think Coach might have seen enough already or wants to go out and finally tell him to throw some strikes.
Needless to say, the hecklers are letting the Cougars hear about it.
There you see Boyd loosening up, and he's not quite ready. You can see that.
They have a nice facility here at Texas Tech. Nice big scoreboard with a message board on it. In fact, the fellow that runs the actual message portion, boy, he loves to invent new little logos and designs. He worked on one for HSE. I want to thank him for saying hi to both Norm and I and all the people at HSE that are here. That's the scoreboard. There it is. You got the at-bat, the hitter. You got his current, his average coming in.
How about those races he had on it last night?
Yeah, they'll have some
that.
Of those probably
sponsor
later.
Races.
Sponsor races. I think he had a soft drink and a tire company. I don't know who was out there. But they, instead of just colored dots, they actually had sponsors. Well, at least their products racing around out there. Conference over. One ball, no strikes. Pitches this inning. Let's see, that gets him up to 62 and just 18 batters. Last 18 batters. And it's two balls and no strikes.
Well, I don't know what Coach Stockton went out and told him, but all of a sudden he's opened up, just kind of flung that ball up there, didn't he?
Last one looked like it. Try to throw that a little harder, but he's lost target altogether. It's three balls and no strikes. Greg is saying, pitching. I got it.
This is my ace, and I'm in trouble.
In trouble. Well, it's been a long year. 5.3 earned run average, and that's a base on balls. And they're loaded. Now, this inning was started out tough. It looked like he was going to get out of it. 28 strikes and 34 balls over his last 18 batters that he's faced.
I think that might be it. If he might let him go one more hitter, but he told his third baseman, go out there and slow him down a little bit. Give me my bullpen guys a chance to get heated up down here.
Course, that's day. Been a it won't take
that,
long.
That bullpen's been a big problem for him.
Yeah. Yeah, he's worried that it'll get worse. That's the problem. All right, but the problem is here, Beach just is showing all signs of being a tired pitcher simply because his control is just nowhere near where it has to be. He's not missing close ones. This is Brody Gregg, who has walked and popped up. There's a strike. That looked nice. That was a good fastball right down the middle.
Well, that's good. Gregg's going to make him work a little bit. You know, that's we said earlier, don't go up there and be too anxious just because you have men on base. Make the guy struggle a little bit.
One and one. And again, that for a hitter, those are gifts when the pitch comes in that far off and you give up on it real quick and you say, aha, I'm that much more ahead of the count.
Well, as a hitter, you're going up there now and you're not worried about fastball, curveball. All you're worried about is getting the pitch and you're in the strike zone because he's just throwing it up there now.
And he threw that one by 2-2. Two balls, two strikes, two outs. Nobody has scored. They've not been able to score yet in the third, but the bases are loaded. Yeah, they did score six times in the second, and Tech leads it 6-3. Popped up right side. It looks like he's going to be out of trouble. Beach is going to take it himself. Does that retires it, but it was a shaky one. In the third, no runs, a couple of hits, no errors. Three left. We'll go to the fourth. It's 6-3 Tech.
The
Each month, there are thousands of hours of sports on television. So how do you find what you want to see? Well, you could check the newspapers and cable listings and all the satellite guides. But what about the other sports programming that isn't listed? There are over 40 sports channels. And don't forget satellite wild feeds or backhauls. Don't ever miss a great matchup again. Jot down this number, 1-800-423-2121, and order the Sportscaster, the only complete guide to all televised sports. Whether on cable, satellite, or off-air, only Sportscaster gives you the TV schedules for every pro and college game, and lots more. It's the most information on televised sports you'll find in one place, guaranteed. With easy-to-read daily program grids and complete listings by sport, it's finally easy to find your favorite team. Call now and you'll get 12 monthly issues for only $29.95. That's nearly half off the cover price. That's 1-800-423-2121 for the Sportscaster.
Rocket Basketball on HSE. You're facing the action. Shooting. Rebounding. Passing. Defense. Bang has got to happen.
The T-Wolves take on the Rockets Tuesday night at 7:30 live on HSE.
Don't miss it.
You're looking at one of the best defensive shortstops that ever played Major League Baseball. That's Roy McMillan. Boy, could he pick the ball up at shortstop. Biggest part of his career with the Cincinnati Reds. He's a native Texan, and he's scouting. Who's he scouting for, do you know?
I don't know. Maybe between games I can find out. He's down there with a few other scouts. Oakland's here, and the Giants are here. And the Yankees are represented.
Dustin Carr leads it off here for Houston, and Carr is even on the count, one ball and a strike. Carr was reached on a shortstop error by Bustos in the sixth, or in the third, or in the second inning. It was E6. Get that right. One ball and one strike. That one stays a little out. Two balls and a strike.
Well, I'd like to see Whittle have an inning like last inning. Only threw 10 pitches. Excuse me, 12.
Yeah.
10 strikes.
That's the way to pitch.
Like those on doubleheader days, don't
you? Tell you another guy, Larry Hayes likes it, even didn't care when. He just likes it. There's a pop up right. Whoa, he's in a little trouble, maybe with the sun, but he held on to it, and it looked like it may have been the sun. If you can judge from where the shadow are, it's almost straight up, and that's where the ball was, but DeRoss made the catch.
Well, you know, what he heard was footsteps of Whittle coming over there.
Yeah.
You know, he's not gaining. You watch it. DeRoss is letting the ball blow right back to him. He's got two things he's worried about, where the bag is.
Mm-hmm. Don't want to trip over that.
And also the big guy's coming over there to help him.
Mike Hatch, the catcher. Mike grounded to the shortstop Bustos in the second. Going to try it again. Bustos on a high hop. Bustos does have a nice arm. He played third base last year and has moved over to short. Of course, at short, you've got to have more range than you do at third. And really, you probably have to have even a stronger arm for the tough plays.
Let's take a look at this last play. Bustos. I'll show you the one thing. Now watch him double clutch. See him? Boom. Boom. Cedeno used to do that a little bit. You like to see him come up, take it out, and throw it. Get rid of that double clutch.
Even if they, obviously he can see the runner. He knew he was not going to have a problem, so he wasn't in any hurry, but I know what you're saying.
What they like to do is double clutch and show that real strong arm. And over a period of a year, that'll take its toll. Catch the ball and get rid of it.
Here's Whiting, reached on an error last time. Well, they're up and heckling now. They got a unison cheer.
They have been quiet.
The wiggle wiggle,
the wiggle, wiggle.
It refers to what he does with his bat before he sees the pitch.
Well,
and
he's calling him back, I think.
Yeah, I think he's
third base up, Roldy swung.
They call that a swing.
Oh, this will be fun.
Oh, he'll let him hear it now.
Yeah, this will. Let's take a look.
That's hard. That's a tough one. But, the bat did get around, But had he given up? See, my argument with this about the bat hit is he had given up on that ball way, but, you know, you can't always tell on the...
Same thing.
Oh, boy, he better quit doing that because this is not the umpiring crew to hold up in that spot. That retires the side. 1-2-3 of the fourth. Bottom of the fourth coming. It's Tech by three.
ACC Baseball. You've got to unleash the aluminum or blow it by a D is the key. And there's only one place to be for ACC Baseball. Maryland and Wake Forest, Sunday night at 11 on HSE.
Tired of taxes, taxes, taxes? At Spears Furniture, we're out to make your tax burden easier with our second annual IRS sale. Inventory reduction at Spears means you can take an additional 7.75% off our already low sale prices. Save 25 to 50% store-wide, plus save an additional 7.75% on bedrooms, dining rooms, and living rooms in stock or special order. So get an early refund this year of 7.75% at Spears IRS sale. But hurry, sale ends April 15th. Spears Furniture, Avenue Q at 28, where the tradition continues.
Folks, your chance of a lifetime has arrived at Frontier Used Cars. Frontier has just received a special purchase of 93 vehicles, all marked down to payments anyone can afford. Choose from a special selection of 1993 Chevrolet Corsicas, all priced at only $172 a month. Your choice of several 93 Nissan Sentras or 93 Plymouth Acclaims, today only $187 a month. Or choose from a 93 Pontiac Grand Am. Again, several to choose from, all priced at only $189 a month. Act now, and remember, used cars come with a warranty at Frontier.
The time is right to build a winner. Driven by power, speed, and pitching, the Astros and Rangers have created the blueprint for success. The Brewers take on the Rangers Wednesday night at 7:30, live on HSE.
To the bottom of the fourth inning, Greg Lucas along with Norm Miller. We're talking about those scouts earlier. Roy McMillan is with Montreal. Other teams that are represented here today, Toronto, the Giants, Oakland, and Baltimore. And a lot of other fans that just want to see baseball. It'll be Randy Duras, Jason Totman, and David Lindstrom. Tech games, of course, are on the radio here. All their games are aired. Fans have a chance to listen in while they are watching so they can believe their eyes. One ball.
And we got a pretty good crowd here today. It's always great.
It's getting bigger, too, as the day wears on.
Yeah.
This game actually started an hour earlier than was on the original schedule because of the allowances for television. So we started at noon. So some of the folks are showing up now. One ball and a strike.
Well, now DeRoss, we talked earlier, who hits home runs. Now he's up there leading off. Let's see what kind of hitter he is as a leadoff hitter.
Two balls and a strike. Well, Beach really needs about a 1-2-3 inning with about six pitches, but he's already thrown three. And that's not the way you get there. Three balls and a strike.
Well, there's nobody in the bullpen warming up. Of course, Boyd should be loose. That last inning lasted about 15 minutes.
And he's on. There's a walk. So that would be, let's see, that's his seventh. I had lost count. Seventh walk. I want to thank Walt McAlexander of the sports information staff here at Tech. He's done a great job on all these pitch counts. And there have been a few to count.
He's the busiest guy up here. He's back here right in the way. Look at him.
Yeah.
Doing it by hand, too. He's got one of those counters in each hand.
Jason Totman had the big three-run triple. Now he bunts and pops it up, and Beach gets to it. Can't make the play back at first, and that's one out.
Well, that was almost a good play. Good base running by DeRoss, because when he broke, he took a look at the ball being bunted and didn't get too far off, so he couldn't be doubled up.
There's a good example of what we're talking about, the differences between college baseball and what you'd see on the professional ranks. This is the number three man in the order. He's a 417 hitter. He just tripled last time up. And because the leadoff man's on base, he's up to sacrifice. And Beach does make a good play.
He came off the mound good. He's got a good follow-through. He's looking at the hitter. He's not off balance, so he got a good job.
David Lindstrom has walked and flied to left. In fact, he made those both appearances in the last inning. That's a ball. The delay was the problem. He stepped off the rubber, but it looked the timing of how he did it, I think, is what caught him.
Well, I don't think anybody totally understands the balk rule anyway.
Well, the key on this one is I thought...
I didn't see it.
Well, if you know, I thought that's what... the back leg comes off the rubber before he does anything, or does it?
No, it didn't.
That's a ball.
No, he stayed in the rubber.
That's a ball. Yeah. He broke the hands before he took the foot off. No, it was a good call. It's one of those that the replay certainly proved it was.
If he just would have had one continuous motion and thrown over there, he'd have been all right. But he didn't step over there. He just broke his hands, and then he just... Is that right?
Right.
That
well, good. Or he, well, no, you're right. Or if he
stepped off
before
there.
He broke his hand,
right.
Then he's okay. He'd
right.
do anything then, but he didn't. He kind of did them both at the same time. Well, in any event, Bill Ross at second. There's a high pop-up on the infield. The wind is taking that over toward the dugout, and it is caught, however, by Matzke.
You know, we keep talking, Greg, about the wind and infielders and outfielders. I mean, you really got to come out and try and take some balls during batting practice, see how bad it is. But see, he let that ball get over his head a little bit. I talked earlier in the outfield,
yeah.
Same thing for an infielder. Try and exaggerate. Keep the ball in front of you so it's always coming back into you. Once that thing gets even with your head and you're going on your heels, well, that's
it'll,
when it gets embarrassing.
Yeah, it'll whip back over your head pretty far. Bustos drives the ball to center. Moving over for his car. And that's it. Well, another somewhat of a struggling inning, but no run score. We go to the fifth. It is a 6-3 lead. Bottom of the fifth, the fourth, I should say. Tech leads it 6-3.
Because most of our flights are short, this is what our meals look like on Southwest Airlines. It's also what our fares look like. Southwest Airlines. It's just plain smart. Frequent flyers on most airlines are thousands of miles from a free trip. But on Southwest Airlines, our Company Club frequent flyer members are only 8 short round trips away. Southwest Airlines Company Club, the shortest route to free trips.
Now there's mulching worthy of the finest lawn.
I keep my lawn immaculate.
Snapper's Ninja Mulching Mower. It set new mulching standards the others are still trying to match. Ninja's double-cutting blade cuts and recuts clippings so fine they seem to disappear.
Looks like I bagged the grass, right? But I didn't.
And Ninja easily converts to bagging. You can mulch this weekend, bag the next. The choice is yours with Snapper.
It is pretty impressive.
Attention college baseball fans. Now's your chance to pick the college player of the year and national all-star team. Plus, win a trip for two to the finals in Omaha. The Smith Series giveaway. To make your picks and enter the giveaway, call 1-900-976-VOTE or mail your info to this address. Remember, a portion of the proceeds go to help the kids at Texas Children's Hospital. Don't forget to catch the winners on a Smith Awards banquet. 223rd on your Prime affiliate. Call 1-900-976-VOTE and help us go to bat for kids.
As we go to the fifth inning, it is a 6-3 score. Great day to be out in the sun, and Tech on top. All the folks in Lubbock happy about that. Top of the order for Houston, Elizondo, Perez, and Freeman. Jason Whittle got even more efficient last inning. What did I say? He threw only 9 pitches last inning, 12 the inning before.
You know, he's pretty much throwing like Coach Hayes said he would if he's to be successful. He's throwing strikes. He's getting his breaking ball over. You know, they've only got 3 hits. And, of course, the opponents against Whittle this year in the Southwest Conference are only hitting 179.
That home run that he gave up to Buteau was the fourth he has surrendered. That is how the Cougars are on the board, a 3-run homer. 1 ball and 2 strikes. Well, he tied him up. That's why you throw inside. He had no chance of hitting that. That's out number 1.
Where are you going to go now? Art Simmons!
You know what's good is Whittle, even though he had a 6-run lead, now he's only got a 3-1 with control. That's just a heck. I'm going to tell you what, nobody can hit that pitch. You got two strikes and a guy throws your breaking ball down and in like that. Just sit down.
Just threw another one, too. Start off the next hitter, Carlos Perez. Perez struck out once. Elizondo, who just struck out, has struck out two times. Whittle has six strikeouts and no walks. He did hit a batter. Nothing in two.
Of course, now he's throwing three breaking balls in a row. In college, they like to do that. You know, they'll go out and throw. Last night, we saw five curveballs in a row. I hadn't seen that in a long time. I like seeing him throw a hard fastball right now just to keep him off balance.
Well, it looks like it may be coming. Outside corner, that's where he was aiming. One ball and two strikes.
And he's got an idea how to pitch.
Foul ball. By the way, those three runs that Whittle did give up in the third were all unearned because of an error which led off the inning. And then prior to any of the runs scoring, the what would have been the third out was recorded. So his 2.81 earned run average hasn't gone up. Swung at and missed on that low pitch, and it's two outs.
Well, how many pitches is that this inning so far? Let's see.
Well, it didn't take him very long.
Here's a replay. Boy, fastball, running fastball down and away. Greg, I think right now we could say he's nasty.
Yeah.
Breaking balls. Breaking balls down and in, running fastballs down and away, two strikeouts.
Eight swinging out of, let's see, seven strikeouts. Must be a six swinging for Whittle. Nine pitches in this inning.
We got some great stats being run in here today, don't we? We'll have to work on penmanship here as we go along, though.
One ball and one strike. That's a foul ball as waved out at third base. It'll be one ball and two strikes. Again, this is the fifth inning of a seven-inning first game, so crucial time for the Cougars, and Whittle not weakening at all.
Boy, here's a boy, Freeman. He's had a good baseball career, hasn't he? I saw him at Bel Air High School several years ago. He loves to play. Friendly kid. Got married, I think, recently.
Yeah, Ricky, senior, 396 coming into this game. Been a nice, solid player for the Cougars. Holds a lot of the school records for hitting. There's a shot to deep left field to the wall. It is up, over, and out. And it's a 6-4 ball game. That ball hit a light tower and came back in, but it was a home run for Ricky Freeman, his eighth of the year, and the second for Houston.
He just is a good, steady ball player. You know, doesn't go into many slumps, comes out to play.
He has now.
Here's the pitch.
He had to adjust for it. He really had to get the hands in.
You know, it wasn't a bad pitch, a running fastball. He just turned on it, whipped it right out. Good piece of hitting.
That was a kind of the exact opposite when we talk about a guy getting extension. He had to kind of bring it in to get the bat head on the ball, and he did. Well, here's Buto, who had a three-run homer his last time up.
Now let's see
for two.
I'm sorry. Let's see how they're going to pitch him here.
He's going to slap it off the glove of Bryant, and he'll make no play. Uncharacteristically, the defense being a bit of a problem here for Tech in this game. Although, admittedly, that was hit very well. Breaking ball. Again, breaking ball. He got that ball hit fairly well. You're right about that, though. It's rare to see a guy who can hit the breaking ball on this level as well as he does. He hits it hard.
And yet the fastball, I've seen him play several games here, and he has trouble with the fastball, especially the fastball up. Maybe I could put a scouting report out here, huh?
Well, and you know, you wonder about that, though. That's one of those things you almost have to have a separate scouting deal with him, because he apparently is looking breaking ball, and if he is, and he's picked off first base. Looking for a pickoff ball, that's for sure, and that retires the side in the top of the fifth. Houston gets a run on Ricky Freeman's ninth, eighth home run of the year, and we've played four and a half, 6-4 Tech.
It's a test of nerves, a play for perfection. The right combination can make you number one. Game, set, match. The Tour Barbecue Rays with the best in Memphis. Martin, Washington, and Chang chase uphill to catch 93 champion Courier in the Kroger St. Jude International. Game, set, match. Semi and final round coverage begins live Saturday at 1:30 on HSE.
Research has demonstrated that the ergogenic effect of carbohydrate.
No other beverage has been proven more effective than Gatorade.
Consuming Gatorade during exercise has been shown to
absorb 30% faster than water.
Gatorade contains the optimal balance of carbohydrates and
water. No other beverage has been proven more effective at replacing
nothing as much as your deep down body thirst better.
Scientifically tested, athletically proven. Only Gatorade Thirst Quencher is liquid technology
for that deep down body thirst.
Come out to play!
6-4 as we go to the bottom of the fifth. Houston will have a couple more chances to get back in this one as we take a look at what's coming up afterwards. Our second game, which will start 30 minutes after the final pitch of the first game. Bo Hernandez goes for Houston with a 2-1 record and a rather lofty earned run average. But Travis Smith, they just keep throwing him out. What a starting rotation that Texas Tech has. He will start the second game. He's unbeaten with a 2.90 earned run average. You know, the tough thing about college baseball before the season, so many college, junior college transfers and other transfers make a team almost a new team every year. That's why Tech, before the season, hard to get a line on them because they had some hitters back, but a lot of these pitchers have really come on and some of them are new and they've had a superb season.
And it's a hard job for a coach. It takes him a while to see what he's actually got.
He has found that he has a lot. Here is Clint Bryant. Had a bit of a struggle at third base today with a couple of errors, but not at the plate. Two hits. First one was an attempted sacrifice bunt that he beat out, and then a double. 2-for-2. Hop that was easy for Matzke, although he had to shuffle around with it a little bit, and there's one out. Matzke goes back to his position, and he'll get in position for the next hitter, which will be center fielder or left fielder Marshall Bennett.
You know, I have to laugh every time I go talk to one of these coaches. They're always, well, you know, we're up and down, we're struggling, and no, you're not, you're winning. Go ahead and be happy about it.
There's Marshall. Couple of flyouts. Ground ball toward the middle, base hit. So Bennett joins the parade. That is hit number 5 for Tech.
I'm sure Coach Hayes reminded his ball club that you guys are only up by 2. It seems like it should be much bigger difference with Beach struggling and Whittle pitching good ball and throwing 9-10 pitches an inning.
And Bragg Stockton is reminding himself how those 6 runs were scored. And that's got to be just galling him because his team's done the big hitting. But his team trails by 2. Runner goes at first. Throw through is not in time. Stolen base for Bennett, who's now 4-of-5 for the season.
Well, they didn't have a chance. First of all, Beach takes a fairly slow move to home. And then second of all, he threw a big slop curveball up there. Hutch didn't have a chance. He might have been better off just holding on to the ball.
Here you see who we're talking about.
They had a big slow curve, and he just kind of flips it over there. Well, he did a good job at least getting rid of it, not throwing it into center field.
Swing through. No balls and 2 strikes. Little bit high.
Let's take a look at the steal here. He's got a real good lead, and he gets a good jump.
Yeah.
He gets a good jump. What's interesting, it was an all-out steal, and he was still looking to see if the ball was going to be hit and play.
Racing over, Freeman makes the catch for the second out. And, of course, holding at second base is Bennett. Potter retired, and Dax Holmstead will be the hitter.
Usually if a runner's, it's an all-out steal. He won't even look at the pitch crossing home plate. If there's a hit and run, he'll take a look in case the ball's hit on his line driver, fly ball, and he has to get back. I think that was an all-out steal. This is one of those great names. You know how I like names. Dax Holmstead. That's a great name, isn't it?
Yeah. He'll step in here and see what he can do here with a couple outs. That's wide outside. Holmstead has popped up and walked. There's a rule in college baseball this year that the hitter cannot step out of the dirt area around home plate without timeout being requested and granted by the umpire. There are some unlesses, though. There are a lot of them. But basically, the purpose of it is to help speed up the game. And actually, it has worked. Some of the coaches that have been asked about it say they're noticing maybe as much as 20 minutes knocked off games because the hitters haven't been wandering around between pitches. Two balls and no strikes.
Do you think it'll ever get out of the college ranks and move up?
I think it's possible. You know, Steve Palermo, the umpire, former umpire, has been hired by Major League Baseball, and his first duty is to study ways of speeding up the game. And not the game. We're not talking about the actual game, but some of the dead time between pitches. Not going to make pitchers take it and throw it necessarily, but a lot of the stalling around. Two balls and no strikes. I had something that I thought would be a unique idea too. A set number of tosses allowed to first base on any particular base runner. So you'd have to conserve them. You couldn't just throw. Yeah.
A quota system.
Yeah. You would definitely not want to get down to that last one because the guy's going to run for sure.
Have you introduced this yet?
No, but
is this the debut of this quota system?
You may throw, let's say, five times, but that's all. So you just don't throw that fifth unless you know you're going to pick him off, because once you've used up your quota, goodbye. Well, Homestead is on after the walk.
Number eight.
Yeah, and it's twice for him. And it'll be the top of the batting order, Brody Gregg. Once again, I think before the game, that's another thing that Bragg told us, that he knows in this case that Beach has thrown some pitches, but he also knows that he's really only got to get through, maybe two more, and they're within two, and he kind of didn't want to go to the bullpen. He admits that he leaves starters in longer than some would. That's why it's important, really, to kind of know the makeup of a particular team, either having seen them play or talk with people about them, because conventional wisdom might say you do this, but if you don't really know what the guy has, there are reasons why they're doing something.
Well, you're absolutely right. And that's a coach's job, to know his players, to know them under different circumstances and situations. And Bragg certainly has been around long enough that he has a good understanding of what his players can and can't do in situations.
One ball and two strikes, and two outs in the fifth.
Well, he doesn't want to get into his bullpen. He's not going to tell you that, but it's obvious. And you got your ace of your staff out there struggling, but they're only two runs down.
Yeah. He's only given up runs in one inning. I mean, he's had, and I don't know if it hit him, but I guess it did. Yeah, Beach is probably going to at least ask if he made any effort to get out of the way on that pitch.
Well, it's tough to get out of the way of the curveball that's following you. You'd have to run to the dugout to get out of the way of that pitch. Here it is. It's just a big, slow, breaking curveball. Where are you going to go?
He moved enough. That's really all you got to do. All you really have to do is move. There may be some people jawing about that, though. Certainly the hecklers are. And so is the catcher, having some words. And the first baseman, Freeman, he's upset. He's having to be kind of held back by Harley Bynum, the first base umpire. And I think they've tossed the catcher. I think Mr. Hatch has been tossed.
And there's Freeman. He almost got tackled by the first base umpire as he was running home to get into this.
Of course, he'll be able to come back and play in the second game, but he's going to sit on this one.
Well, some of those calls, Greg, are subjective. And that's certainly, if I was on the Houston side, I can see their point. Did he try and get out of the way? But, you teach a hitter to stay in there.
Well,
you teach a hitter to wait on the ball and stay in there.
Let's look at it again. I think it was a good call simply because he turned the shoulder away from the pitch. He didn't turn it into the ball. And that's all you got
to
do.
But as a hitter, he's supposed to, you teach them all their lives to wait on that ball and hit that ball up the middle. He's doing his job. The pitcher didn't do his job. He hit him.
Let's see. Yeah, I know what, Houston's frustrated. Things have not gone well, but that replay certainly would indicate that was the proper call on that one.
Oh, no.
Beach has thrown 85 pitches, 40 strikes, so it's more balls than strikes. And now we're going to get a new catcher. This will be for Houston. That will be Molesky. Molesky has come in, and he'll catch. So that will do away with the designated hitter. Molesky will come in and catch. All right, well, while he's warming up, some things to tell you about. First of all, we got a second game here, but don't forget, Rangers' first home game on HSE will be their first night game ever in the ballpark in Arlington, and that'll be preceded by a special sports talk. Norm Hitzkus will host that with Barry Switzer, the new Cowboys head coach, starting at 7 o'clock. And then at 7:30, Texas takes on Milwaukee. Now, those of you in the Houston Astros markets will not see the sports talk show. The Astros are playing that night with their activity starting at 6:30. But you'll be joining the tail end of the Ranger-Milwaukee game. The Florida game starts an hour earlier, so we expect to have you with us before the end of that game is over. In the meantime, Molesky has come in to catch. And he's all set. The bases are loaded, and they have been loaded a few times during this game, and unloaded once on a triple back in that six-run inning by Totman. And Beach will get to toss a couple to Molesky.
I'm not that familiar with the DH rule, but that doesn't mean that now means the pitcher, Beach, will have to hit in the eighth spot, doesn't it?
Right, that means Beach is actually in the catcher's slot,
right,
which is eight. And we're all set to go.
You're used to that American League rules.
They never do this. They never put DHs in the game. There you see the setup. The bases are loaded. Bennett is at third, Homestead at second, and Brody Gregg is at first. The hitter is Randy Duras. Only the number one home run hitter on this Tech team with the bags jammed.
33 RBIs. He'd like to add four more right here, I'm sure.
Hitless in this game, 0 for 2 at a walk, and he takes a strike. He grounded to third in the first, bounced into a fielder's choice, but brought in a run with that in the second, and then walked in the fourth. And that bounces, and that hit him. So another run scores.
I got to tell you, this is one of the strangest games I've seen pitched in a long time. And I say that because every once in a while, Beach will throw a fastball right over the top for a strike and a good breaking ball, then all of a sudden you get this.
He has now hit a runner in and walked two of them in during the course of this game and yet only allowed seven runs. The others have all come on that three-run triple. And the hitter now is Totman, the man who had it. He tripled back in the second inning. The drive-in three, that's his first and only hit. Base is still loaded, 7-4 Tech. One ball and a strike. Word is out for the Cougars to get somebody ready. That's a pretty good fastball. Threw it past him. One ball, two strikes.
Well, let's take a look here. There you see Bill. What's all that stuff hanging from his glove?
He's done a little restringing himself, hasn't he?
You know, I'm surprised umpires haven't stopped that. That can distract a hitter a little bit.
Up the middle, base hit. This will be two more runs batted in for Totman. Here comes the throw through, but it's cut off by Freeman. And Totman has had five runs batted in.
Well, you know, what's interesting right there, Greg, if you see that replay of Beach, is he really doesn't pick up his target to the very last second. You know, there's some guys, remember Valenzuela, used to look up at the sky.
Yeah.
But the rule of thumb is you got to pick up that target a little earlier than he's doing. And, you know, it causes wildness, and that's certainly what we've seen today out of the left-hander.
Eighth man to hit the inning now, David Lindstrom, with runners at first and second, three runs in, and there's a fly ball to right field short. In fact, the second baseman and the first baseman going for it. Now the wind, and it drops in. A Base hit, one run, and here comes two runs at the plate. No, two more runs score. And the Cougars just are falling apart here. That was very poor communication, and they're a very poor reaction.
Well, this might really drive Coach Stockton nuts. There's a basic fundamental, in no matter where you play baseball, on a pop-up, the infielder goes back. But any ball an outfielder can get, he's got to take. But that infielder doesn't back off to, here's that outfielder. In that case, the right fielder wanted nothing to do with the ball. Buteau just kind of glided and never took control. You got one guy going back trying to catch a ball, one guy coming in. The guy coming in should have taken it.
Lindstrom gets a pop fly hit, two-run score. It's 11-4 Tech. And a hitter is Saul Bustos. Boy, they have used the best of their hits. 11 runs on only 7 hits. And that was one of them. And that retires the side. Well, they blew it out of the pond, it would appear. It's 11-4, a 5-run inning for Tech. We go to the sixth. Tech leads Houston.
Check out SEC Baseball for plenty of RBIs, ERAs, SPs, Ks, and HRs. So watch ASAP, okay? Vanderbilt in Auburn, Saturday night at 9 on HSE.
Bike Corner, quality bikes at affordable prices, like Mongoose and Ross mountain bikes priced under $200. For juvenile, road and mountain bikes and the professional service to back them up, come to Bike Corner. You'll find the best selection in the Panhandle. Bike Corner, where you always get more for less. Before you decide, come see us. Affordable, durable, quality, selection, and service. Bike Corner, our only business is bicycles. Plains and Avondale in the Avondale Shopping Center in Amarillo and 2004 34th in Lubbock.
Golf Digest introduces 8 ways to a better golf game. It can help you experience a game that's better all around. Get the 8 ways to a better golf game video. It's guaranteed to improve your game, and it's free with your paid subscription.
Order 12 issues of Golf Digest for just $19.77 now and get the latest video free. Call 800-232-2700. That's 800-232-2700.
It's a real drag. The nation's meanest machines go head-to-head to see who is the real deal on wheels. The 25th Annual Cater Nationals, Sunday on HSE.
Well, things got a lot prettier for Texas Tech in the last of the inning. They score now 5 more. They lead it 11-4. Sixth inning coming up for Houston. It'll be Molesky, Matzke, and Carr. Molesky has struck out and singled. And he hits the ball high in the air to center field. Homestead, the center fielder. One down.
When you get down in the late part of the game like this, you love to see that first hitter making out. Boy, go right after him. Makes it so much easier.
Whittle and his teammates only need 5 more now. Again, this is the 7-inning first game of the doubleheader. Matzke, the third baseman, has flied to center and bounced into a fielder's choice. One ball. In the second game, we'll start 30 minutes after the final out of game 2. We will be sending it back, but we will be back. And the pitching matchup in that one is scheduled to be Bo Hernandez. There's a liner into the glove of Bryant.
Well, I bet you Bryant feels better. He's made 2 errors in this ball game, but he's a converted third baseman.
He's done a good job here. He stayed right with it. Ball's hit hard.
Used to be a left fielder. They brought him in this year to play third base.
Made room for him when the Bustos went to shortstop. He had played there last year. 2 outs down. Dustin Carr is the hitter. Have a pinch hitter, actually. This is 18 in the lineup, not 17, Dustin Carr. This is Scott. In fact, I was just noticing we have a pinch hitter on deck as well. That would be the beach slot. There's a chopper out to second base. And so Scott's retired. That retires the side. So 1-2-3 in the sixth as Houston is knocked down, and we go to the bottom of the inning. It'll be Bryant to lead off for Tech.
The way to not win in tennis is to think too much about your opponent. Because in tennis, you don't just play the opponent. You've got to play the ball. It's how you play the ball that determines whether your shot is in or out. Whether the point is won or lost. Play the ball better than your opponent, and you'll play winning tennis. Now, you can play the ball and win with this double offer from Tennis Magazine. You'll receive a free half-hour video by Tennis Magazine instruction editor Vic Braden, plus a full year, 12 issues of Tennis Magazine. Call this number now and change the way you play tennis. What a combination. The How to Play Winning Tennis with Vic Braden video, plus the magazine that brings more instruction to more tennis players than any other.
Call 800-592-1222 for a full year of Tennis Magazine, plus this free video, just $13.77. Call 800-592-1222 now.
We talked about that scoreboard. How about that? A personalized welcome to all the crew here at HSE and all of you folks at home around the five-state area that are watching baseball. We want to thank everyone for, we thank them for that, too.
In lights.
Nice to have your name up in lights, right?
In color.
In color. There's where we are. We're up in the... See the arm waving? That's us. We're in that little room right in there. I don't know if we can get in. Where's the camera?
Wait.
There it is.
Take my glasses off. Showing my age.
There's Mr. Stats behind us, Walt McAlexander. Boy, he's the guy keeping track of all these pictures.
Here, Walt.
Yeah,
wait,
yeah.
Jim.
He's the guy keeping track of all these
stats. Walt's not quick. He's good at those stats, but he can't get on camera.
Mr. Numbers. Well, folks, now this is above our location. This is the guy taking all the wind. You got to like that scaffold stuff.
But he's not tethered down. You told me he was going to be tethered down. You know how I worry about those guys.
Here's Bryant now. Bryant's going to lead it off here in the sixth. There is a new pitcher on the mound for Texas, for Houston, rather. Keenan Boyd, a junior college transfer from Eastfield JC out of Garland South High School.
He's 2-1 so far this year. 23 innings pitched. A 4.56 earned run average. For this team, that's not too
actually
bad.
No, I was going to say that's about a run under what the team average is. So see what he can do here, pitching in the sixth to Bryant, Bennett, and Potter. And I am looking out into center field, and I do believe staying into the game out there in center field was Smith. Or is that
Scott?
Smith? Scott.
Chris Scott.
No balls and two strikes. Off the glove of the side of the pitcher. Nicely covered by Whitting, so there's one out.
That ball might have tricked the pitcher, Boyd. He hit that thing right off the end of the bat. Let's take a look. Boyd, just kind of a slender, typical relief-looking pitcher, sinker slider ball, right off the end of his glove. Thought he had it.
Tough on that second base. He got changed directions very quickly, but it's a good play.
But he was moving in when the ball was hit, so that helps.
Marshall Bennett. Bennett is 1-for-3. One ball and no strikes. Houston has 4 runs on 4 hits. 2 of the hits have been homers. In fact, the homers have scored all 4 of the runs. Tech has no homers, but they've scored 11 runs. Now, on the season, Tech has, coming into this doubleheader, hit 42 home runs. Houston had hit just 28. Another thing that's amazing about the Tech pitching stats, look at the home runs. They've only given up 16, and that means, you know, they're playing an awful lot of their games here, especially their non-conference games. Only 16 home runs with the wind blowing out like it does here. 16 coming into this game, now 2 more.
Well, I think their pitching coach is Coach Anderson, isn't it?
Yes.
Our hats off to him. Coach Hayes gave him a lot of compliments before the game.
He sure did. He, however, is not a noted basketball player. If he ever has to make a trip to the mound, you'll see what we're talking about. He's all racked up because he played some basketball with some of the players. I think when they had their trip to Oklahoma and he's injured, he can barely walk.
How would you describe that move to the mound in case we don't get a chance to see it today?
Kind of tipped over sideways and listing to the left.
Boy, it takes a while. He needs to get a head start.
Here's Luke Potter. See, is that about 9 or 10 walks as a team?
I think that's nine.
As a team, I think you're right. 8 by Beach, now 1 by Boyd.
We got a couple hit by pitches, a lot of 3-1 counts.
Let's see, we have a pinch hitter here. Looks like we might. This is
Brandon
Wells. Well, we're getting to see Brandon. He did not start the game, despite the fact he's one of the top 5 hitters in the league. Left-hander started, so he did not. He's hit 8 home runs. 1 ball and no strikes. Loop to left, and that is going to be Perez making the catch. Oh, boy, that was somewhat of an adventure. But when he got to where the ball was, he was able to get the glove under it.
Well, he came in on the ball, and then he's kind of hesitated, and then he dove, and then he rolled, and adventure's a good word.
Yeah.
He surrounded this thing.
Yeah, okay.
There, he's got it.
It's a little farther. Two outs. And now Homestead. Runner goes. Pitch fouled back. Hit and run. No balls and a strike. Well, again, I guess that again points out the unfamiliarity with the wind conditions. He probably was laying back a little bit because he figured it was going to come to him, and it didn't. It was really weakly hit.
Well, it did come to him a little bit, but I don't think Perez is that quick out there. And it's tough. We're sitting up here. We can't feel it. We can see it. In fact, I'm glad I'm sitting up here not playing in this ballpark.
No balls and a strike. And maybe they can designate it here to be okay. Never deal with the wind.
Well, it's like Candlestick.
No balls and a strike, except probably about 20 degrees warmer. At
about
least
40 degrees warmer.
That ball gets away, and runner goes into second base. So Bennett in scoring position.
It's just a little slow breaking ball in the dirt. Catcher got down on his knees and tried to block it. And that's all you can ask a catcher to do.
Yeah, he was squarely in front of it. There were no holes for the ball to get through. It just had that spin and got away. 1 ball and a strike. Two outs in the bottom of the sixth. On the corner for a strike. Coming up in the top of the seventh, which will be Houston's last chance. Scheduled is the pitcher's slot, and then Whitting and Elizondo. Too high, 2-2.
For the rest of the year, the Cougars are always a visiting team, more or less, aren't they?
That's right. They're having to play the rest of their home conference games at Rice because Cougar Field is no more. There's a pitch that is down and away. It is being demolished to make way for a brand new state-of-the-art college baseball facility starting next year. It's going to be a dandy. It'll be, I'd have to say from the looks of it, it's going to be third only to Texas and Texas A&M in the facilities. That takes care of the half inning. Houston coming up in the seventh. They need to score 7 to tie. We'll be back.
Research is demonstrated that the ergogenic effect of carbohydrates.
No other beverage has been proven more effective than Gatorade.
Consuming Gatorade during exercise has been shown to
absorb 30% faster than water.
Gatorade contains the optimal balance of carbohydrates and water.
No other beverage has been proven more effective at replacing
nothing as much as your deep down body thirst better.
Scientifically tested, athletically proven. Only Gatorade Thirst Quencher is liquid technology.
For that deep down body thirst.
Come out to play!
It's springtime on the fabulous Star of Texas. Fun? You bet. Now sail for only $19 day and night sailings except weekends. Call now 1-800-495-2121. Special $19 ticket price includes two free buffet meals, free Las Vegas-style shows, and free entry to the three famous Gold Star casinos, and 7 hours of sailing on the world's largest day cruiser. 1-800-495-2121. The Star of Texas, where Texans love to play. Galveston.
Polyurethane treads, air cushion heels, deep grooves. All designed to enhance performance, making these soles tough shoes to fit.
The Dallas Mavericks are making strides.
Cutting, pivoting,
leaping,
doing whatever it takes to take the air out of the competition.
At HSE, we're not just showing off our shoes. We're showing that the Dallas Mavericks have some tough soles.
The Nuggets take on the Mavs. Friday night at 7:30, live on HSE.
Last chance for Houston in the top of the seventh. The seventh inning started. We got a pinch hitter. It's Brad Towns batting and being heckled. Every move he makes is described.
The wiggle chair's back.
This would be the epitome of descriptive play-by-play on the radio, wouldn't it? They're telling you when he hits his hat.
You know, he's got to hear it. He's got to laugh. Step out and just have him laugh. It is funny. Listen to this.
Well, the worst thing is if you're just doing that out of routine, not even thinking about the fact that your bat's moving, you're going to say, oh, gee, my bat's moving.
Well, you're not. Suddenly, you can't focus on trying to hit a ball coming in 85 miles an hour.
Three balls and a strike.
College baseball, it's great, isn't it? Hard ball in Lubbock.
Oops.
Yeah, he wiggled.
All right. Base hit for Brad Downs. Coming up off the bench is a pinch hitter. Brad out of the Dallas-Fort Worth area with his pinch hit single. Towns out of Mesquite, just east of Dallas. And now the hitter will be another pinch hitter. This will be Weed. This is number 29, Nathan Weed. He's from Spring, Texas, near Houston, Klein Oak High School. And he will bat for Whitting. Weed, right-handed, as you can see. Swings and misses that one. Trying to find him on the sheet here. Where there he is, he's had 22 at bats with four hits. No balls and two strikes. If you're wondering about Whittle, this would be, if he can get three more outs, his fourth complete game and his eighth win. Breaking ball, chop, third. Foul ball.
And a good thing.
Yes, very good thing. And that was a good example, and I know a lot of people, still a lot of people don't know that rule. It was where the ball was. The home plate umpire makes the call before it gets to the bag, and you'll see the ball was in foul territory when the third baseman touched it. It has nothing to do where the third baseman is. There it is, foul ball. And it was a good thing because he whipped it almost into the bullpen.
Bryant's kind of an adventure down there at third base. He is in a learning, as they say, learning the position.
Yeah, that's it for Weed for the first out. And let's see, eight strikeouts for Whittle, and the hitter now will be back up to the top of the order, Ryan Elizondo. Elizondo struck out twice and singled. Runner at first base,
Towns, he singled as a pinch hitter leading off the inning. Ball one. That one stays outside. Thing about Whittle, I think it's interesting, as big as he is, the pitcher, 6'1", 231. In high school, he was a football quarterback.
Well, we got to get his
quarterback.
Well, how big was he back then? Maybe he's a late bloomer. Although, to look at his thighs, I would have to say that he's been fairly substantial all his life.
Two balls and a strike. Foul ball.
I'll tell you what I like about him. Like I said earlier, I thought when I saw those strikeouts per innings ratio, we got a big, strong power pitcher. But he's pitched a good ball game because he's thrown strikes, and he's changed speeds, and that's exactly what Coach Hayes said he had to do in the scouting report to win today's ball game.
Foul again.
He's around that plate, but he's never over the plate. He's a little bit here, down and away, up and in, slow breaking balls, puts a lid on it. He's done a heck of a job.
Scattered five hits. Four runs, only one of them earned, however. And just missed on the corner there. He has not, up to this point, walked anyone.
Two long balls, but those are the only two balls that have really been hit hard. The hitters have been kept off balance most of the game.
That's foul. Yeah, let's see. I'm looking back at my sheet. I think you're right. Matzke hit the one-liner that Bryant caught. That was well hit. Elizondo's one hit was well hit in the two homers, and there were a couple other hits that weren't.
That's not bad.
No. And you're right, too. There were very few hard outs. There's a well-hit ball. It laced into right field, moving to second base and holding there is Towns. That's the second hit of the inning. And the sixth all told. And the hitter will be a pinch hitter again. This will be number 13, Murphy, Michael Murphy. Murphy has had 43 at-bats with seven hits. That comes out to a 163 batting average. One homer, six runs batted in. And a first pitch of ball.
Out of the A-Leaf, your hometown, A-Leaf.
Yeah, let's see.
A-Leaf Hastings. Isn't that out by you?
It is.
In Houston
it's
area?
It's the wrong high school, as far as my son's concerned, but...
Yeah, but he's a neighbor.
That's right. One ball and no strikes. We got a little delay here. I think he's walking a little better today. Let's take a look at our Southwest Airlines play of the game. This was back in that big inning. Two runs had already walked in, and then Jason Totman, with the bases loaded, hits the ball into the gap. Our Southwest Airlines play of the game, just plain smart play of the game. And maybe not smart by the defense in center, in a little tight, but it certainly was smart by Totman hitting the ball on the button and driving in three. He has actually had five runs batted in today. Pitches this inning for Whittle. This is the most in any single inning in the entire game. That's not really a bad inning. And of course, it's not over yet. There's only one out.
Well, way over on the South 40, they've got the Texas Tech bullpen going. They've got a left-hander and right-hander. I can't see the numbers. Maybe we'll be able to get a camera over there. But
hey,
Coach Hayes, they're on the top step. They're not going to let them. They'd like to see him get a complete game, but they're certainly not going to let this get out of hand here late.
Texas Tech about to go 6-2 in conference play. Again, that would be, depending on the outcome of TCU's game today, that would be top record in the loss column in the league. Two outs and another strikeout. That gets him up to 9.
Well, that was the perfect situation where you wanted a strikeout. And he went after that hitter. Hard breaking ball. As I said, he's changed speeds. He's done a good job.
Here's Ricky Freeman, who took him out of the park the last time up. Ricky is 1-for-2. And a fastball wide, one ball.
Good location. I don't think he'll give in to Freeman. The next two hitters are tough, with Freeman, obviously, and Buteau coming up. But you can't be too cautious.
Two balls and no strikes. Freeman up to 35 runs batted in this year, and he takes that one wide. It's 3-0. Well, the next guy is just as tough, if not tougher. That's Shane Buteau. He's on deck. Three balls and no strikes with two outs here. And that didn't take long. And for the first time, Whittle walks a man. Base is loaded with two outs for Shane Buteau. Shane struck out in the first, hit a three-run homer off of Whittle, and then reached on an error. That's foul back.
Let's see how he pitches him now. We've talked all game that he's an off-speed hitter. He's got bases loaded. Let's see how Whittle goes after him. Breaking ball down and away. Of course, that was out of the strike zone, so now he's way ahead. Now you don't want to make the mistake and give in to this guy. Boy, if you're going to throw him another off-speed pitch, I sure wouldn't get it into the strike zone.
He's
especially
way, set up
low.
Way outside. Catcher was way outside, Lindstrom, and it was wide. One ball and two strikes.
See, I think Buteau, with those long arms and that big swing, you can come up and in on him.
He went. That's it. Ball game's over. So Texas Tech wins game one of the doubleheader by a final score of 11-4. Whittle getting the victory, beats the loss. We'll be back to recap briefly in just a moment.
It's the Battle of the Sunshine State. Hang on tight. The power of the Canes collide with the muscles of the Tomahawk Chop. The Hurricanes take on the Seminoles. Game 2, Saturday night at 6, live on HSE.
My name's David Acock. Been a general contractor in Lubbock for 35 years. I just want you to know I'm real proud of my Dodge truck. This truck pulls 30,000 pounds. That's what the weight is on it right now. It pulls it easy. I get extremely good fuel mileage. I get 13 to 14 miles to the gallon pulling this rig in town or out of town. I just can't emphasize the fact how good this truck is. My 94 Ram truck is on order for Frontier.
Bike Corner, quality bikes at affordable prices, like Mongoose and Ross mountain bikes priced under $200. For juvenile, road and mountain bikes and the professional service to back them up, come to Bike Corner. You'll find the best selection in the Panhandle. Bike Corner, where you always get more for less. Before you decide, come see us. Affordable, durable, quality, selection, and service. Bike Corner. Our only business is bicycles. Plains and Avondale in the Avondale Shopping Center in Amarillo and 2004 34th in Lubbock.
Time is right to build a winner. Driven by power, speed, and pitching, the Astros and Rangers have created the blueprint for success. The Mets take on the Astros Sunday at 1:30, live on HSE.
There's our game summary. It was Texas Tech with two big innings, doing all their scoring in two innings, winning 11-4. 11 runs, 7 hits, 3 errors. They left 7. Houston, 4 runs, 6 hits, 1 error. They left 6. Whittle had 10 strikeouts, only one walk. He threw 92 pitches. 61 of them were strikes and only 31 balls. That's amazing. Totman was 2-for-4 with 5 runs batted in. The only home runs were both by Houston, a 3-run homer by Buteau and a solo homer by Freeman. Well, Norm, it was great pitching by Buteau, and of course, once again, proving if you keep those extra guys off base, which he did, you can win and be in command, and he was all day.
Yeah, that first game was Jason Whittle pitched a good ball game, and they had some timely hitting. A little problem with defense for the Cougars. Of course, Beach just didn't have anything today. You can't walk 8 or 9 men and hit some batters and win a ball game.
By the way, Whittle, of the 4 runs, only one of them was earned. I'll be back with some final things on this game in just a moment.
It's time for friends to fly free on Southwest Airlines.
Wake up and smell the coffee.
And people are friendlier than ever. Just make reservations at least a day in advance and buy your round-trip ticket at Southwest's regular low unrestricted fare, and a friend flies with you, free, anywhere we fly.
Yo, Dad, what do you think?
Friends fly free on Southwest Airlines. It's just plain smart.
Basketball fans, the finals of the season have rolled in, and that stands for madness. Only 4 schools earn the right to meet in Charlotte and show the nation their best slams and jams and battle it out for the 1994 national championship. And now you can get in on the excitement. This year, the NCAA has licensed a Final Four ball cap like no other. The official NCAA cap has the Final Four design stitched on the front, along with the school logo of the Final Four teams. You can get them put on the bill or on the back. You decide. They make great gifts for fans and collectors. And to get one, all you do is call 1-800-933-3276. But you better call early. Quantities are limited and supplies will not last. To order the official NCAA Final Four cap, call 1-800-933-3276. The caps are just $19.95, and T-shirts are also available for only $19.95. That's 1-800-933-3276. Call now.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Let's go!
The countdown is on as the nation's top team, brightest stars, fieriest competitors bring it home game after game. The goal is simple. Win it all. Rise to the top. Be the best.
There's a laser to the left side. It is a base hit. This ball game is tied.
The hits are here. HSE College Baseball. Swinging for the fences. All season on HSE.
The Southwest Conference Game of the Week is brought to you by Southwest Airlines, the official carrier of the Southwest Conference. It's Dan Law Field where Game 1 has been played. Texas Tech now has won the first two games of this series, clinching the series and putting a further dampening on Houston's chances of making the postseason tournament. Their record now 4-7 in conference play. Texas Tech 6-2. They still have their eyes on the top spot overall. The executive producer for Home Sports Entertainment is Mike Anastasiou. Today's game has been produced by Bob Steinfeld and directed by Kevin Spivey. Our technical director, Stan Black. Engineer in charge, Jason Totman. And remote facilities provided by Mountain Mobile Television. Coming up in just about 20 minutes after we take time out for prime cuts. Once again, the final score of this first game, 11-4 Tech over Houston. For Norm Miller, the crew, and everyone else at HSC, Greg Lucas here saying so long from Lubbock. This has been another exclusive presentation of Home Sports Entertainment.